So after understanding what an embedded system is and what the difference between a general computing system and an embedded system is, let's go down to components of embedded systems. And I will mention that the things I'm talking about in this course are not only about embedded systems, it's about computing in general. But really, since most of the systems we have and the largest spectrum of them are embedded, I'm going to really be using embedded systems as kind of an example and then going over to things that you would find in higher end CPUs or higher end embedded systems in certain places in the course. So this is kind of a typical embedded SoC. It has a lot of stuff over here. It has an embedded processor. It has different, you know, types of memory. It has different types of peripherals and IOs. It has different types of timers and watchdogs, power management, sensors, analog, clocking and reset, and additional application-specific things. So let's go and talk about each and every one of these very briefly. Later on in the course, we'll go into much deeper detail into many of them. So I'm going to use this kind of picture based on something that I found on ARM to go over the different components, because this is a type of a block diagram that you may find in various embedded systems that we'll be seeing. So at the heart of it, we almost always have one or more embedded processors, and that's because we want programmability. So I'll be discussing that in the next lecture, but we're really going to want to be able to write some sort of software, some sort of higher level code that we can go and carry out all kinds of algorithms and control the whole thing. So we have at least one of these embedded processors inside, and it will be optimized for general purpose use. Usually it's going to have lower functionality and performance than a desktop processor, which the whole thing is just to have really, really high performance. Here, its main operation, depending again on the actual application and system, is just going to be to control the whole system. Okay, it's going to run some sort of software, which can be a real-time operating system. It also may run what we call bare metal, which it just, you know, kind of jumps to the first instruction in the program and goes on from there. Again, we'll be discussing this throughout the course. It's also going to be the primary master of bus transactions. So we're going to talk about a bus in a minute, but usually the initiator of any type of a transaction is going to be the microprocessor or other things, but really the microprocessor is going to be one of the masters. The second thing we'll always have pretty much is embedded memory. So this embedded memory can be really tightly coupled to the microprocessor. I think that the microprocessor can't run at all without some sort of tightly coupled memory, but we also might have some secondary memory that's going to be hanging off the bus. And this can be, you know, things like a boot ROM that will be able to load our program onto the microprocessor and be able to run our program, but it also can be some RAM that's going to have volatile stuff to store transient input or output data. Okay, we usually will not have any type of secondary storage like a hard disk on an embedded system because of our, you know, size constraints, power constraints, latency constraints. So we're going to be really limited in things like code size. And so something that you probably wouldn't think about on writing a regular computer program, how real small your actual code is going to be. Here you need it to fit inside the RAM, inside the boot ROM, and so forth. So code size becomes an important factor that we didn't maybe think about before. The second thing I wanted to discuss, which is kind of the heart of the embedded system, is the system bus or the communication bus. And there may be several buses on an embedded system. As we said before, the microprocessor will usually be the master of most transactions, but there may be multiple masters if we have several microprocessors or all kinds of other things such as the DMA, which we'll discuss in a minute, which can be a master on the bus or some sort of external type of master that can really start transactions. So we're going to have a whole system of multiplexing and decoding the different address and data, and we'll be discussing that in depth in a future lecture, even arbitration between the different masters. There also may be different buses inside and different levels of buses. For example, we may have a high-speed primary bus that can provide us low latency and all kinds of complex functionality, but we may have some sort of a bridge that brings us to a low-power bus so we can save the complexity of designing for a high-speed bus. So as I mentioned, we also have often a DMA controller, which is a direct memory access unit. And what it basically is it's a piece of hardware that offloads the microprocessor from doing all kinds of memory transactions. So in general, if a microprocessor wants to take, you know, some, the boot code and move it over to the RAM or something, it would have to take each address and read it and then write it over to the RAM. And that would take many, many operations that would have the microprocessor working all the time on that. So instead of that, it can just give a range of memory addresses to the DMA and say, copy them. And the DMA will then take control over the bus and do that while the microprocessor continues doing other stuff. So a DMA is, again, something that's very commonly found inside a system on chip. We can't actually have any computational system without some sort of an I/O, some sort of input-output. I mean, what would the chip do by itself if it couldn't communicate with the world? And we call these, input-output interfaces, we call them peripherals. So all these things that really are at the edge of our unit and then are connected in some way to the outside world, such as a UART or USB or other types of things, these would be called peripherals. So we usually have these, a lot of these, there are different ones, and here's an example of UART, and we'll be discussing this again in a future lecture. Another important component of system on chips and of embedded systems in general are timers. So we'll have lots of these counters all over the place inside the chip that are used for different things. So they may just count the clock pulses and see how long we've been running. But one of the important ones we call a watchdog, which really sits there and sees if any process became kind of a runaway process and never finishes its operation. And then we'll either interrupt the microprocessor and tell it, listen, there's some sort of runaway operation, take controller, or more commonly just reset the whole system because something went wrong. So we have different timers that cause these different things to happen, especially in real-time systems, and we may have a watchdog for more emergency situations. Sensors and analog, so of course the whole world outside is basically analog, and these cyber-physical systems really are there to interface with the world to do something that has to do with the external world. So we have to have sensors, actuators, and all kinds of analog parts that are for transferring between the analog domain outside and the digital domain that we're going to be using inside our computer. An interrupt controller is a very important piece of hardware that actually enables these different external peripherals to stop the microprocessor's operation and tell it, listen, there's something we have to do. So when I move my mouse over here and I want this little light to move, the mouse is going and saying, listen, microprocessor, I want to move. So the interrupt controller will find that out, tell the microprocessor, stop what you're working on, stop calculating the last digit of pi, and go and update the position of the mouse over there. So an interrupt controller is a really important part of an embedded system. So, of course, you can't do anything in a synchronous system without a clock. So we have, a clock will often get a reference from some sort of external crystal or something like that, but it has to multiply the clock and make sure that we can talk to external type of devices. So we'll probably have a PLL on the chip, and we may have all kinds of very sophisticated reset circuitry, such as a power on reset, that will ensure that we don't start operating until we have enough power inside our chip. And of course, we have a power management unit in these types of systems, which will, on the one hand, be able to take the external power supply, the external battery, and then deliver it in all the different voltages that we need around the chip. But it may also be able to turn off different parts of the chip to save power while keeping other ones on all the time to do all kinds of important tasks. So with those as the main components of a system on a chip or an embedded system, let's discuss the application software and real-time operating system. So the features of embedded software, the program code often resides in an embedded flash or in a read-only memory. It won't be in a hard disk or something like that, such as you would be used to from a regular, home desktop type of a system. The storage space for variables is allocated in the RAM, and we'll be discussing that. And program should execute continuously. As we saw before, there's this while one loop that just continues and continues running. There is no exit function. And it should be capable of handling all possible exceptional conditions, such as I mentioned with the watchdog timer. If all of a sudden something hangs up, we have to have some sort of functionality that will go and reset the system or kill whatever that runaway process was. With that, we have a real-time operating system, which is something that often sits between the hardware and those types of embedded programs that will able to that will enable us to manage them. So there's a scheduler that manages the execution of multiple tasks on a certain piece of hardware, and it should schedule the tasks and interrupt service routines such that they're completed within their deadlines, because it is a real-time operating system, so we want to make sure that it gets things done on time. It sets the rules during the execution of application processes to enable finishing of a process within the aligned time interval and within assigned priority. So we can really discuss what is a more important thing to do and what is less important to do, and make sure that they will actually meet their deadlines. And to do that, we have semaphores that prevent multiple tasks from simultaneously writing into shared memory. So these we'll also be discussing later on in the course. And two of the very popular open source type of real-time operating systems are FreeRTOS and Zephyr. As a summary for this introductory lecture, we discussed the definition of different categories of computing hardware: microprocessors, microcontrollers, systems on a chip, general purpose computers, and embedded systems. And we took a brief look at the components of an embedded computing system. From here on in this course, we will go deeper into these components and how they communicate and work together. And I really took things from a lot of references, and I tried to, you know, put a source on each and every figure that I use and so forth. But really, here are a bunch of the books and a bunch of the courses and so forth that I use to create a lot of the things we're going to be discussing in this course. Though, again, I use a very wide array of different things that I found on the internet or in the library and so forth. So I hope you guys will enjoy this course, and I'm looking forward to providing the next lecture soon.